When I said at parting that I would come again some time, she replied, "Say in a long time, that will be nearer. Sometime is no time." We met only once again, and I have no express record of the visit. We corresponded for years at long intervals, her side of the intercourse being, I fear, better sustained. And she sometimes wrote also to my wife, enclosing flowers or fragrant leaves with a verse or two. Once she sent her one of George Eliot's books, I think Middlemarch, and wrote, "I am bringing you a little granite book for you to lean upon." Other times she would send single poems, such as these. The Blue Jay. No brigadier throughout the year so civic as the jay. A neighbor and a warrior, too, with shrill felicity, pursuing winds that censor us, a February day, the brother of the universe was never blown away. The snow and he are intimate. I've often seen them play when heaven looked upon us all with such severity I felt apology were due to an insulted sky whose pompous frown was nutriment to their temerity. The pillow of this daring head is pungent evergreens, his larder, terse and militant, unknown, refreshing things. His character, a tonic, his future, a dispute. Unfair an immortality that leaves this neighbor out. The White Heat. Dare you see a soul at the white heat? Then crouch within the door. Red is the fire's common tint, but when the vivid ore has sated flame's conditions, its quivering substance plays without a color but the light of unanointed blaze. Least village boasts its blacksmith, whose anvil's even din stands symbol for the finer forge that soundless tugs within. Refining these impatient ores with hammer and with blaze, until the designated light repudiate the forge. Then came the death of her father, that strong Puritan father who had communicated to her so much of the vigor of his own nature, and who bought her many books but begged her not to read them. Mr. Edward Dickinson, after service in the National House of Representatives and other public positions, had become a member of the lower house of the Massachusetts legislature. The session was unusually prolonged, and he was making a speech upon some railway question at noon one very hot day, July 16, 1874, when he became suddenly faint and sat down. The house adjourned, and a friend walked with him to his lodgings at the Tremont House, where he began to pack his bag for home after sending for a physician, but died within 3 hours. Soon afterwards I received the following letter. The last afternoon that my father lived, though with no premonition, I preferred to be with him and invented an absence for mother, Vinnie, her sister, being asleep. He seemed peculiarly pleased, as I often stayed with myself, and remarked as the afternoon withdrew, he would like it not to end. His pleasure almost embarrassed me, and my brother coming, I suggested they walk. Next morning I woke him for the train and saw him no more. His heart was pure and terrible, and I think no other like it exists. I am glad there is immortality, but would have tested it myself before entrusting him. Mr. Bowles was with us. With that exception, I saw none. I have wished for you since my father died, and had you an hour unengrossed, it would be almost priceless. Thank you for each kindness. Later she wrote, "When I think of my father's lonely life and lonelier death, there is this redress. Take all away. The only thing worth larceny is left. The immortality." My earliest friend wrote me the week before he died, "If I live, I will go to Amherst. If I die, I certainly will. Is your house deeper off? Your scholar." A year afterwards came this. "Dear friend, mother was paralyzed Tuesday. A year from the evening father died. I thought perhaps you would care. Your scholar." With this came the following verse, having a curious 17th century flavor. "A death blow is a life blow to some, who till they died did not alive become, who had they lived had died, but when they died, vitality begun." And later came this kindred memorial of one of the oldest and most faithful friends of the family, Mr. Samuel Bowles of the Springfield Republican. Dear friend, I felt it shelter to speak to you. My brother and sister are with Mr. Bowles, who was buried this afternoon. The last song that I heard, that was since the birds, was, he leadeth me, yea, though I walk. Then the voices stooped, the arch was so low. After this added bereavement, the inward life of the diminished household became only more concentrated, and the world was held farther and farther away. Yet to this period belongs the following letter, written about 1880, which has more of what is commonly called the objective or external quality than any she ever wrote me, and shows how close might have been her observation and her sympathy had her rare qualities taken a somewhat different channel. Dear friend, I was touchingly reminded of a child who had died this morning by an Indian woman with gay baskets and a dazzling baby at the kitchen door. Her little boy once died, she said, death to her dispelling him. I asked her what the baby like, and she said, to step. The prairie before the door was gay with flowers of hay, and I let her in. She argued with the birds, she leaned on clover walls, and they fell and dropped her. With jargon sweeter than a bell, she grappled buttercups, and they sank together, the buttercups the heavy. What sweetest use of days! 'Twas noting some such scene made Vaughan humbly say, my days that are at best but dim and hoary. I think it was Vaughan. And these few fragmentary memorials, closing like every human biography with funerals, yet with such as were to Emily Dickinson only the stately introduction to a higher life, may well end with her description of the death of the very summer she so loved. As imperceptibly as grief, the summer lapsed away, too imperceptible at last to feel like perfidy. A quietness distilled as twilight long begun, or nature spending with herself sequestered afternoon. The dusk drew earlier in, the morning foreign shone, a courteous yet harrowing grace as guests that would be gone. And thus, without a wing or service of a keel, our summer made her light escape into the beautiful.